doesn't give me more than 5. Is there a reason for that? What? It did that the other day. Did that the other day, it took it a while. Difficulties. Can't get anything to connect. So we think that we are live on YouTube and Facebook this morning, but we're not really sure. And you'll have to let us know if we have good sound, except that I can't see anything. I'm trying. Okay. All right. So yesterday we had to do a breakfast with Santa instead of breakfast with spaniels, because Hugh and I had volunteered to work the breakfast with Santa for the local Roratans group, which is a fundraising group to help families in need. And so we do it every year, and it's really fun for us. But it did mean that we had to interrupt our discussion of lab results. So we talked about lab results for liver disease the other day, and today I thought we'd continue. I still can't see any comments. I thought we would continue with lab results for... Oh, yeah, I don't want to do that. Thought we'd continue with lab results for kidney disease. So... Okay, and some people were nice enough to send me some results on some cases that they were dealing with, and we discussed them a little bit. So, okay, so we talked about a bunch of this stuff. Let me get down to, okay, BUN. So BUN, which is blood urea nitrogen, can also give some indications of liver disease as well as kidney disease. So the BUN is blood urea nitrogen, which are the waste products from the breakdown of protein and that circulates in the blood. It's usually cleared by the kidneys, and we have to have a functioning liver for the BUN to actually show up in the normal range. So for dogs and cats with a liver shunt, which we generally are going to see at a fairly young age, if they have a liver shunt, their BUN may be, you need to turn that down now, the BUN may be artificially low. For pets that are fed a high meat raw diet, the BUN may be slightly above the normal range, and veterinarians who aren't familiar with raw feeding may freak out a little bit. So if you are feeding your dog or cat raw food and you don't want your traditional veterinarian to know that, and then they're calling you up and saying the BUN is high, take that with a grain of salt, and you can either tell them or not tell them. Oh, by the way, the spaniels are in coats and they're all fluffy because they had baths this morning and they're still wet. Okay, so BUN, if it's very high, so the normal range for this particular lab is up to 31. The dog I'm looking at, the BUN is 40. And I don't know if this is a raw fed dog or not. But the BUN will be elevated if the kidneys are not clearing the nitrogen waste products from the body. So when we have a pet who's in kidney failure, the BUN will be elevated. And if the BUN gets high enough, it will cause nausea. It will cause ulceration of the mouth and the intestines. So we'll have animals that don't want to eat. It will cause their breath to be very foul. It'll be what we call uremic. So it's an ammonia smell coming from the mouth. And if it's high enough, it will stop these dogs from eating and cats. So when we have pets that are in either acute or chronic kidney failure and they're not eating, a lot of times it's because their BUN is too high. By using fluid therapy, so either sub-Q fluids or IV fluids, we can bring those levels down. So the BUN can also be elevated if they have GI ulceration and they are bleeding into the bowel or the stomach. So sometimes if I see a normal creatinine but a very high BUN, and if they're a little bit anemic, then that says to me, oh boy, we better look for some ulcers or a stomach tumor or a bowel tumor that might be causing bleeding into the bowel. Another thing to look for would either be blood in the stool or a dark tarry stool, which is basically digested blood. So the creatinine is more specific for kidney function, and that is a specific enzyme that will go up when the kidneys are not able to function the way that they need to. So normal for this lab is up to 1.5. This dog is 1.4. So the creatinine is normal. The BUN is a little bit elevated. So I would start thinking that maybe, let me see if this dog's anemic. I would start thinking that maybe this is a raw fed dog. Nope, this dog is anemic. This dog might be breaking down red blood cells. Maybe we've got a stomach ulcer in this dog. So I'd have to look at the stool and do an exam on the dog to know for sure. Okay, what else is related? So some of the electrolytes can be wonky with kidney problems. Potassium can either be elevated with kidney failure or it can be too low with kidney failure. If they are on diuretics like Lasix, they're going to lose potassium and we might need to have to replace that. This particular lab, this is IDEX lab, they have a specific kidney function test called an SDMA. And in this dog, it's high. Now, I've seen the SDMA go up during times of stress. This dog might be a dog who's in chronic kidney failure and they've managed to stabilize. That's why the BUN's a little bit high, the SDMA is a little high, the creatinine's running in the high normal range. So again, I would have to know a lot more about the animal. But a lot of people freak out. The normal SDMA is up to 14, and a lot of people freak out when it hits 15, 16, and their veterinarians will say, oh my gosh, your dog's in early kidney failure. And a lot of times I just have the people do a diet change and put the pet on some kidney protective herbs, and that'll come right back down on the next lab work in a month or two. So I don't freak out if it's just starting to elevate a little bit, but you know, it is just, it's an early warning indicator that we should be protecting the kidneys. So a couple things that we can use for protecting the kidneys food-wise would be dandelion leaves and dandelion root. We can use asparagus. There's a product called Aminovast, which is an amino acid supplement. And I would start feeding some kidney in the diet. And then the other thing, which is not on this lab arc, the other thing that we absolutely want to look at to determine kidney function is the urinalysis. So there are certain things that we are going to look for in the urine test, and it's so critically important to get the urinalysis because it truly is impossible to know how well the kidneys are really functioning without that urine. And it's often overlooked because it can be a pain to collect a urine sample. We use a ladle on the end of a broomstick. We just duct tape it on there and it works really well. But some dogs get really scared when you're following them around with a big stick. We also have little trays. You can use a flat pan that you slide under them. But you need to get that sample. Michelle Allen from Monkey's House can actually collect urine samples in plastic baggies. She has Ziploc plastic baggies that she can get under those dogs with, and she does really well with that. So whatever it takes to get that sample, we need that sample. Worst case scenario is you take the pet in with a full bladder. So that means don't let them urinate before you leave home. Don't let them urinate when they get out of the car at the vet office. Carry them if you have to so they don't urinate on the way in. And we use our ultrasound probe and find the bladder, and we can do what we call a cystocentesis, which is pull the urine with a syringe and a needle. But we need that urine sample because if they are able to concentrate the urine, then the kidneys are working. So we do something called a specific gravity. And if it's in an elevated range where they're able to concentrate the urine, the kidneys are working. If it is extremely dilute, then maybe the kidneys are working to dilute that urine. So we'll see that sometimes with certain disease situations like diabetes insipidus. Sometimes we'll see it in diabetes mellitus. So, you know, it might be an indicator that there's a problem, but it might not be with the kidneys themselves. If the kidneys are not able to concentrate the urine, it's coming out with a specific gravity of 10-12 to 10-16, then the kidneys are not doing their job, and we need to figure out what's going on there. So we're going to look for protein in the urine. If we're spilling protein in the urine, that's an indication that the kidneys are not working very well. If there's red blood cells, that could be that there's inflammation or stones up in the kidneys. If there are white blood cells, then we need to be looking at an infection that could be affecting the bladder or the kidneys. And we also look for something called casts. And casts come in different kinds, but if we're seeing casts, that's basically a little, it's a little cast of the kidney tubules. So they're basically, it shows that there is damage going on to those kidney tubules, and we need to, again, look at what's causing that and get the problem stopped. It's usually an inflammatory problem. So when you're looking at kidney disease, things that you absolutely need to test, if your pet has kidney disease and you're monitoring, you need to look at the electrolytes, you need to look at the BUN and creatinine, you need to look at the urine. Pets with chronic kidney failure will become anemic. The kidneys are responsible for making the kidneys make a hormone, that tells the bone marrow to make the red blood cells. And if the kidneys aren't functioning and making that hormone, then red blood cells don't get made and the pets will become anemic. Okay, that's kind of a quick Sunday morning. Sorry, that's a lot to digest on Sunday morning, but you can go back and replay it. And we're going to figure out this new program. We think it's working. We're not sure. We'll go back and look, but looks like it is on Facebook at least. And Hugh says it's working on YouTube. All right, so Hugh will see if he can get us any music. This handbell music that we were playing is from a church down in Virginia. Teresa Carpenter had her kids' handbell choir do breakfast with spaniels with handbells. Pretty cool.
Wet dogs. Thank you.